The Bible reads in 1 Peter 3, beginning with verse 1, "Wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they, without a word, may be won by the conduct of their wives, when they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear." Verse 7, "Husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife, as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered." The scriptures could not use any better concluding language to grab our attention as married Christians than "that your prayers may not be hindered." We count on praying with the confidence God hears our prayers. But God makes it clear that by mistreating our spouse, we may forfeit this special privilege. Louise and I married 26 and a half years ago. It doesn't seem possible that we've been together that long. I've now spent more years married than single. If you're married, can you remember back to your wedding day? Do you remember the vows you made? Are you keeping your vows? We want to reflect on our most crucial earthly relationship after our song. When you think of your spouse, and when you think of your marriage, what thoughts come to mind? Someone wrote of their spouse, "You are the cheese to my macaroni. You are the horizon to my sky. You are the bacon to my eggs. You are the jelly to my peanut butter. You are the smile to my face. You are the gravy to my mashed potatoes. You are the bubble to my bath. You are the ketchup to my French fries. You are the water to my ocean. You are the icing to my cake. You are the colors to my rainbow." If only that childlike spirit typified our daily thoughts, attitudes, and actions regarding our spouse and marriage. Someone else said, "Marriage is like a walk in the park, Jurassic Park." Unfortunately, that metaphor describes too many marriages. Too many marriages even between Christians. Our wedding day is huge, but how often do we look back on that day? How often do we reflect on our wedding vows? We made vows before God and man. We do well to ponder the seriousness and the sacredness of our wedding vows. We read in Psalm chapter 50, verse 14, "Offer to God thanksgiving and pay your vows to the Most High." If you are single and contemplating marriage in the future, please listen carefully to the Holy Spirit's words in Psalm 56, 12. "Vows made to you are binding upon me, O God." The world has long been too casual about marriage, but unfortunately, more and more Christians do not treat marriage as the sacred institution ordained of God in Genesis 2, verse 24. There the Bible teaches, "Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." The bride and groom eagerly exchange their wedding vows when the time comes, but those vows are enforced not just for that day. And it's not till debt do us part, D-E-B-T, but till death do us part. When we marry, we solemnly give our word to love and honor one another. We did not merely vow for better, for richer, in health. No. When you married, you likely exchanged vows similar to these: to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. We appreciate those who so honorably and so tenderly live up to their marriage covenant when tragedy and great difficulty strike their home. I know I am blessed by reminding myself of what God thinks about the vows that I made. In Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 21, we find, "When you make a vow to the Lord your God, the Lord your God will surely require it of you, and it would be sin to you." We were all a bit naive on our wedding day, weren't we? Love is blind, but marriage is an eye-opener. The first couple weeks of marriage awaken husbands to the importance of the Spirit's message in 1 Peter 3, verse 7. "Husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered." I thought getting married on December 21st would be great because Louise came from a football family. Her brother played quarterback, and her dad coached for a number of years. Louise even kept stats on the sidelines. So with our honeymoon in late December, I assumed we would get to watch many college football bowl games together. I misjudged the intensity of Louise's enthusiasm for football. The Bible says husbands must dwell with their wives with knowledge. We need to listen. We need to pay attention. Where do you take your marriage cues as a husband or a wife? Co-workers? Pop culture? Social media? Too many Christian husbands act like Archie Bunker or Nabal. Too many wives act like Roseanne or Jezebel. If we really want a marriage that thrives, we need to look to God's instructions in the Bible. Wives, for example, need to respect their husbands and submit to them. Meanwhile, husbands need to treat their wives with the same love and care that Jesus showed and shows to the church. The Holy Spirit outlines God's plan in Ephesians chapter 5, beginning with verse 22. "Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything." Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. As goes the marriage, so goes the family. As goes the family, so goes the church. As goes the church, so goes the culture. Listen, you can do no greater favor to children, friends, and neighbors than living out the Spirit of Christ in love before them. And if the Lord has blessed you with children, modeling love to all, but especially modeling love to your spouse, is the single greatest gift you can give to those little ones. Dr. Lisa Firestone wrote an eye-opening article in Psychology Today. The article, titled "How Your Relationship Impacts Your Kids," posted online October the 1st, 2010, had the subheading, "How Do Negative Interactions Between Parents Hurt Children?" The article read in part, "When a study group recently asked kids to answer how they could tell if a couple was married, one answer that kept arising was, 'If they are arguing, then they are probably married.' This response might seem comical if it were coming from an adult, but coming from a child whose interactions are far from getting a laugh, the answer is much more unsettling and much more worthy of our consideration. Whether we like it or not, our children are watching us all of the time. The saying that children are like sponges absorbing the world around them is especially true of the emotional atmosphere that surrounds them. When it comes to the relationship between their parents, no irritated eye roll goes unseen, and no whispered criticism goes unheard. No matter how hard we may try to conceal problems, children are sensitive to the tensions between their parents and are directly influenced by the way their parents interact. Many of us can remember occasions from our own childhoods when our parents were so involved in their emotional states that they acted as if we were invisible. Now, as parents, there are times when we are so immersed in an interaction with our partner or spouse that we forget that we have an audience in our children. We may try to fool ourselves that they are distracted playing on the floor, but little is likely to slip past them when it comes to dynamics between their parents. Whether it's a parent who yells a lot, or one who acts in a sullen and angry way, these patterns directly impact our children when they are young, and they often go on to reenact them in their own relationships when they reach adulthood. Dr. Firestone ends the article with these words, "When a parent's own emotional needs are met, they offer their children a sense of stability and security from which to experience the world. A parent's happiness allows children to feel happy and to trust that parent to meet their emotional needs." Yes, when you become a Christian, you owe it to God to love and respect your spouse. But get this, you also owe it to your children to show them by example what love is all about. Genuine love involves lifelong commitment. Jesus says in the context of marriage in Matthew 19, verse 6, "Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate." Friends, never forget what Jesus said. Marriage is a sacred covenant relationship. When a husband and wife truly love God and love one another as the scriptures teach, the marriage they form cannot help but endure. This kind of marriage will survive any crisis. Listen, friends, this is such an important biblical truth. You don't fall in and out of this kind of love. The Spirit says in 1 Corinthians 13:8 that this love never fails. The love and commitment that exists between two Christians is undergirded by one even greater, that love which they have for God. If Louise and I truly love God first, nothing will be able to separate us. James Orton explained in his book, Marriage in a Chaotic World, quote, "Marriage is a contract between two eligible partners to live together for the physical, mental, and spiritual benefit of the individuals, plus the action God performs in joining the two together. Peace, joy, and harmony become the rule, not the exception, when a couple lives out God's plan." It is easier to say, "I love God," than to do what God says. Many more people say they love Jesus than really do. Talk is cheap. Jesus said as much in John 14 and verse 15. "If you love me, keep my commandments." When obeyed, God's commands bless our individual lives, our marriages, and our families. Let's take that another step. Doesn't God test our love for Him through the love we show for others? The Bible teaches in 1 John chapter 5, verses 2 and 3, "By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep His commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome." We answer the question, how much do we love God, by demonstrating how much we love our neighbor, Matthew 22, 37 through 39, and even by how much we love our enemies, Matthew 5, 44. These relationships are challenging, but demand only minimal interaction. It is easier to say, "I love God," than to actually love one's brother. But our fellow man is the child of God by creation, and more significantly, our brothers and sisters in Christ are children of God in a special sense. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 20 and 21, we read, "If someone says, 'I love God,' and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? This commandment we have from him, that he who loves God must love his brother also." Obviously, we cannot read each other's hearts, but God can. The Spirit says we show our love for God by how much we love our brother, but this responsibility is also limited by time and opportunity. Granting these truths, then, the ultimate test really of how much I love God is how I treat my spouse. Doesn't that make sense? When we marry, we pick each other to be the one person in the world that we will most fully show our love for God by how thoroughly, consistently, continuously, and unendingly we love each other. This relationship is far more concentrated in time and extent than any other relationship, more than your relationship with your parents, your children, and your close friends. Martin Luther said, "Let the wife make the husband glad to come home, and let him make her sorry to see him leave." May that ever describe your marriage relationship. You will show the degree and intensity of your love for God in how selflessly and thoroughly you love your spouse. Again, 1 John 4:20, "For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen?" So, I can't be praising God and verbally abusing my spouse. Colossians 3:19, "Husbands, love your wives and do not be bitter toward them." James chapter 3, verse 9, "With it we bless our God, the tongue, and Father, and with it, our tongue, we curse men who have been made in the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so." The Bible emphasizes how all our relationships, but especially our marriages, should look. In James chapter 3, beginning with verse 17. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Genuine biblical love means we esteem others better than self, Philippians 2:3. Winston Churchill had the right spirit when he said, "My most brilliant achievement was my ability to persuade my wife to marry me." A good marriage is one where each partner secretly suspects they got the better deal. What is love? Manuel H. 8 said, "I think you're supposed to get shot with an arrow or something, but the rest of it isn't supposed to be so painful." The best definition for love I have heard, for its clarity and simplicity, is active goodwill. Feelings may follow agape love, but feelings cannot be equated with the love we see in God. Bible love behaves a certain way towards another, no matter how deserving the individual, no matter how they treat us, and no matter how they make us feel. Marriages fail because at least one spouse fails to add true love to the romantic love on our wedding day. The scriptures offer a 15-fold description of love in 1 Corinthians 13. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. We must exhibit all of these attitudes and behaviors, but understanding and avoiding two of the most practical descriptions of what love is not will greatly enhance and strengthen any marriage. Love is not rude. Let's remember this in our marriage and families. Love doesn't behave in an unbecoming manner. The rude man says, "I could care less what affects you. I'll do what I want whether you like it or not." Love is not thoughtless. Love is not careless. Love is not graceless. Love is not rude. If I am more concerned about speaking my peace than I am about producing the right effect by what I say, I need to learn to control my tongue. I need to learn to bite my tongue. One wife said, "Sometimes I wake up grouchy, but sometimes he wakes up on his own." The Bible says, however, love is not easily provoked. Another translation says, love doesn't fly off the handle. Another, love is not irritable. We get our English word paroxysm from the Greek word translated provoked. Paroxysm means sudden outbursts. Love is slow to get upset, irritated, or angry. Love does not look for a fight. Someone has said, the first to apologize is the bravest. The first to forgive is the strongest. The first to forget is the happiest. Some circumstances demand righteous indignation, but the Spirit tells us in Ephesians 4:26, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. Many times we get too angry. We get angry too often. We get angry too easily, and we get angry for the wrong reason. Angry words wound and confuse. When I blow up, I revert to early childhood. I want my way, and I want it the way I want it. And if you don't do it the way I want it, somebody's going to pay. In contrast, consider the practical words of Proverbs 15:1. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. When the Christian witnesses a baptism, he sees Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. When the Christian observes the Lord's Supper, he sees the body and blood of the Lord and the new covenant he set in motion. When the Christian considers the marriage relationship, he thinks of Christ and the church. Each of these suggests sacredness. We'll be back after our song.
Redeemed how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child and forever I am, redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood.
Contact us to receive a copy of That Your Prayers Be Not Hindered, number 1156. We also offer our free study guides on the inspired Word of God and a better covenant. Visit LetTheBibleSpeak.com to review video, audio, and transcripts of over 400 Bible messages. Join our YouTube channel to watch the new sermon every week at your convenience. Finally, we echo the sentiment of the Apostle Paul when he wrote in Romans 16:16, "The churches of Christ salute you."